What's up, everybody? Excuse me. This is the Fates of Warned. Just here to do a little overview of this past year in films. This is basically just an overview of 2012 in film. I'm going to be just going over a list of the films that I saw from worst to best, and then afterwards I'll be giving just a few little awards afterwards. I'll try not to go too long onto each film, obviously, because I'm doing a list here. But, so basically, yeah, the main rules for the thing for my list are the film had to have been given an official release in 2012. If it was released, an official release, box office release, I mean, not like if it's played at, if it was played at a film festival or something. So as a result, because of that, I'm including Zero Dark Thirty on my 2012, list, not my 2013 list, not in the 2013 list, because even though it technically came out in my area in 2013, it did come out in, New York and Los Angeles. It did debut in New York and Los Angeles in 2012 at around Christmas time, so I can't technically consider that a 2013 film. And also, unfortunately, that means I'm going to have to exclude the film Coriolanus. At least I think that was how it's pronounced. I don't remember exactly how it's pronounced, but... That means I'm going to have to exclude the film Coriolanus, which was released, which was technically not given a full release until, a full theatrical release until this year, but technically, sorry, I'm adding on one more thing here to my little list that I've got here. Anyways, but the film Coriolanus, it was a film directed by Ralph Fiennes, at least I think that's how his name is pronounced. Again. But yeah, most people will probably know him as Voldemort, and they also saw him, you also may have seen him as basically the new M in the James Bond franchise. Well, at least that's what it looks like, the role that he'll be taking on now. And it was an adaptation of a Shakespeare play, but it was a pretty unique style of adaptation. It's had itself set in modern day, and it basically it was like if the Roman Empire existed in modern day, and it was a very... It was a very unique setup, and there were some... I really liked how it was able to execute its premise. Like, there was... there are some instances in the play where the public are kind of talking while... they're kind of talking about what the events that are going on. And they actually managed to do some very clever stuff with it. They actually take those scenes and they make it sort of like a television conferences that are going on, so it's very cool how they set it up, and I was very impressed with just how much attention to detail was put into it, and just how well they managed to do it the way they did. Unfortunately, there were a few instances though where it seems to stretch credibility as far as to how realistic it looks, but then again, that you're always going to have that problem when you're adapting a play into a film, adapting a play into film. So, but I still really like the movie, and I would definitely recommend it. I saw it on Netflix several months ago, so. I'm not sure if it's still on there on there for live streaming, but if it is, definitely check. You should definitely, you guys should definitely check it out. Okay. So, anyways, let's get started with the list here. At the very bottom is, and now again, I didn't see every film that came out last year. I mostly was trying to avoid. I was mostly trying to avoid seeing the bad films, so I mostly went to see either films that were well reviewed or I had a lot of interest in. Fortunately, most of the films that I had a lot of interest, there was basically only three films that I was going to see, regardless of how well reviewed they were. And those were The Avengers, The Amazing Spider-Man, and The Dark Knight Rises. The Avengers was actually my least anticipated, and that ended up... It's quite strange, because my most anticipated at the beginning of the year was... Actually, technically, my most anticipated was The Amazing Spider-Man. But the one that I was thinking was going to be the best was probably The Dark Knight Rises, and... it was a little bit, and I still had high hopes for the Avengers, but I wasn't quite thinking that it was gonna be as good as it was. But then I ended up seeing it, and it was incredible. So I was proven wrong, and it basically kind of flip flopped as to where I was expecting everything to come out. So basically. But yeah, this is most of these films were released in theaters, with the exception of one film was released direct-to-video that I did see from this year. So, with that being said, let's get on with the list. At the very bottom of the list, I have Snow White and the Huntsman. I remember going, my dad and I went to go see this film. We didn't really have a lot to do, and there really wasn't much going on. I was more looking. I really mostly went there because my dad wanted to go see it. I was just like, okay, if you want to go see it, then I'll go see it with you. And it was by far the worst film I saw all year. My dad actually did kind of like it, but I think. And also my mom and my brother ended up liking it, but they both went to see Mirror Mirror, which I heard was even worse. So that's probably I stayed far away from that when I heard the word of mouth about it. So, but yeah, I think I probably got a better viewing of what this film actually was because of the fact that I didn't see Mirror Mirror, and it was just. I was just bored to death watching this movie when I was in the theater. Basically, the biggest problem was it was so flat and lifeless. There was very little character at all to the film. I mean, the only character that was at all close to being three-dimensional was the villain, Queen Ravenna. But that wasn't good enough to really... But as it is, all it did was really just try to give her more of a motivation, and that ended up working, but it wasn't good enough to really carry the film, and the premise was way too thin. I felt was another big problem of the film. It was just could not carry the time frame that it had in the. That it had, and also there was a lot of it frequently pulled out the whole "it's magic, we don't have to explain it" card, which a lot of fantasies unfortunately have the tendency to do. And there was a lot of, and as a result, it really just felt like they were just coming up with contrivance after contrivance after contrivance just to help keep the plot going. I really felt that the plot was just completely relying on contrivances, and that was part of what made it really, really bad. And it was just a boring-ass film. I was just really bored watching this. And of course, Kristen Stewart's performance was just terrible. I mean, that was the one thing that... They agree with that. Everybody that my family agreed with me on that. Kristen Stewart was just fucking awful in this film. But then again, Kristen Stewart's not that good. Is a pretty bad actress. Although maybe she could be better if she was given better roles. Because I mean, you gotta admit, With both Twilight, well, the problem, one of the problems, though, is she's working with crap material. I mean, if she was given better material, she might be able to be a better actress, but I still can't see her being much better actress. But, I mean, she's both in, I mean, seriously, she's been working in Twilight, obviously, for her infamous role as Bella Swan, and now she's in this, and even if it, I don't really, and even then, I really don't think any actress could have pulled this off, because it was just so, there was just no character to the, just no character at all, and there was, it was really, I was just bored to death watching this, so, by far the worst movie of the year for me. Up next is, the film John Carter. I ended up seeing this with, my friend, back around, it was back around late March, right before I went back to work. And, it was, really, this movie was really disappointing. The trailers didn't really, well, first of all, I think I was really hoping that this could have been a good film, because it did have the potential to be a good film, but it doesn't quite have that, I would say. First of all, it's clearly, the biggest thing that there was a few things that I felt were, quite often during the movie, I was either really bored or I was really confused as to what was going on. I was really confused as to whether or not the film was trying to be science fiction or science fantasy. I'm not saying that. I really wish it picked what the film wanted to be, and it needed to really have a better sense of direction to it. And there was no real. I just couldn't quite understand what was going on at sometimes, and there was a lot of stuff that needed better explanations or needed better stuff that needed to be more clarified. And then there's the third act really got into third act syndrome. The third act really, when you learn the villain's plan in this movie, it becomes ridiculous, and a lot of stupid stuff happens at the very end. So I will admit that was at least at that point, it did kind of become entertainingly bad, but for the most part, it was kind of a case of, it doesn't quite know what it wants to be, and I was really disappointed with this movie. I was really hoping that this movie could have been a lot better, and of course, Taylor Kitsch was just bland in this role. In his role as John Carter, I kind of feel sorry for this guy, although he could have decided to not be in Battleship, which I refuse to see this year, but, I really feel sorry for this guy, because he just kind of got himself in a bad situation this year, and he can be good. Taylor Kitsch can be good when he's given the right role and is given the right amount of direction, but it just was not that good. And really disappointed in this movie. This ended up being a big letdown. Anyways, moving on. Well, probably to the film that infuriated me the most, and that is Prometheus. I really hated this movie. I will state this, I don't hate this nearly as much as Alien vs. Predator. Part of the difference there, though, I mean, the difference there, the real, one of the things though there, though, was, it's, at least this film was well-directed, where, as opposed to, Alien vs. Predator, where you have the awful direction from, of Paul W.S. Anderson, who's probably one of the worst filmmakers around today. But Prometheus is, but that being, and I, there were really two reason, things that kept me from putting this, below John Carter. And the first thing was excellent direction and excellent visuals as well. That really kept me into the, into what was, that really were, I mean, though the visuals were absolutely amazing. But second of all, it did at least get me hooked into the premise. It at least, I mean, at the beginning, despite all of its problems, it at least got me interested in what in the story that they wanted to tell, and then they didn't even tell it. It got the but the very, very end of this film, the very like the last hour of this movie result culminates in quite possibly the worst ending to a film. No, it is the worst ending to a film that I've seen this whole year. This ending was horrible. And I cannot believe that a lot of critics were giving this 4 stars or 5 stars or whatever. But it was just a horrible, horrible case of a horrible case of third act syndrome and just absolute, I mean, any goodwill that was built up in the first hour of this film was completely destroyed by the last hour. You have enormous plot holes coming out of nowhere, plot twists, a really weak plot twist that doesn't make any sense. You have a completely unexplained plot that just, you have a completely unexplained motivations for the aliens. I mean they state that they want to destroy Earth because I'm not sure, but we're not really sure as to why they want to destroy Earth. And that's, I mean, not destroy Earth, destroy humanity, but we're not really sure as to why. And it's absolutely, I mean, it's just absolutely it's absolutely frustrating that they don't give us any of this crap that we should be getting in this movie. If you're trying to establish a room for a sequel, then at least give us enough background to want to go to see the sequel. And, God. It just had an awful script. This was really, really bad writing, overall. Some of the worst writing I've seen all year. Comes very close to being, I mean, if it wasn't for Snow White and the Huntsman, this would be the worst script that I've seen all year. And it's just absolutely, absolutely terrible, terrible at the very end. And if it wasn't for the excellent direction and great acting and the first act that actually gets you into it, despite the fact that there's still some stuff that doesn't make sense at the very beginning, it does really, but this movie was just a humongous letdown of everything that was anticipated this year. This was pretty much one of the most anticipated movies of the year, and I absolutely despised it. Anyways, after that is Iron Sky. I ended up seeing this one after its theatrical run. I saw it on DVD. We ordered it on Netflix from DVD, and then right after, it's strange, because right afterwards it ended up going on to live stream. So, I kind of would have wished that my dad had ended up seeing it first, so that way he could have told me about it, but, it wasn't terrible ending. It wasn't a terrible movie. It was stupid. But I knew fairly well that it was going to be stupid going into it. But I mean, this is a case of this is clearly a case of the people knew what they were trying to do, but they couldn't... I mean, the people at least knew what they were trying to do, but they couldn't quite do it. I don't know why, because it was like, this was like the greatest premise for a hilariously stupid movie ever. I mean, Nazis hiding on the moon since 1945 finally decide to come back to invade the Earth in the year 2018, which, by the way, they state that there's a presidential election going on in the year 2018, which should not be the case, because the next... Yeah, you can tell that this is made by Finnish people, because... I mean, by foreigners, because they say the presidential election takes place in the year 2018, and which is not the case. The next presidential election will be in the year 2016, and the next one after that will be in the year 2020. So there is no presidential election in the year 2018. But yeah, I kind of like the whole Sarah Palin parody with that president, though. I wish they had gone further with it, though, and I wish it was more ridiculous, because, I mean, I knew it was going to be stupid, but it needed to revel in that. It really needed to just completely revel in that stupidity, and, but it doesn't quite do that, and as a result, it's not as much of a cheesy, fun movie that I was hoping it would be. I think this just needed to, they really... couldn't quite roll with the premise, I think. They at least didn't take it... It at least didn't take itself seriously like some other films with ridiculous premises have done recently. So, but it was at least a film that managed to make itself feel... I mean, it at least didn't do that, but it was still not quite as good as I was hoping it would... Not quite as much fun as I was hoping it would be. I mean, if you're gonna be stupid, you gotta revel in that stupidity, or otherwise it's not gonna be any fun. Next is the only documentary that I saw last year. I still have not seen Jason Becker Not Dead Yet, which is the documentary that I really wanted to see last year, but it was not playing anywhere near me, unfortunately. So as a result, the only documentary I saw last year was, well, it was one of those old political documentaries that come out around the time that the election comes out, and of course that one was 2016 Obama's America. I mean, well, what did you expect? We all knew that this was going to be very politically charged. I will at least state it wasn't as politically charged as it could have been. It wasn't as, It didn't, but my biggest problem was the guy really seems to keep jumping to conclusions at points. I mean, he provides good evidence, but I don't quite see how they lead to the conclusions that he comes up with. Nor do I see how they really make the film nor do I quite see 100% see the arguments. I mean, I see it, the problem is I see it as more theoretical than actual fact, and that's the problem. Documentaries should really be trying, what you really should be trying to do is trying to present facts, and it doesn't feel like it's trying, it doesn't feel like it presents facts. It presents a factual conclusion. It really just presents a more theoretical conclusion, and it's just I really wish that this had been more. That this had been more. It just been a better... I mean, I'll state this first of all. I do not like these kind of documentaries to begin with. The problem is I don't like these politically charged documentaries to begin with. I'm not even a big fan of Michael Moore, even though... I mean, the one thing about Michael Moore, though, is at least his stuff is very entertaining. So that way, it at least gets you interested. But this one's just kind of... just kind of just presenting stuff to you, and it doesn't really result in a conclusion that feels, you know, that feels like it's telling the truth. It just feels like it's the guy trying to get out what his theories are and presenting them as fact. And it's that doesn't work at all when you're trying to present an argument. So I gotta give this one a thumbs down. Anyways, so those are pretty much the bad movies that I saw this year. And the next few are like the mediocre ones at that. The ones that are mediocre to average. So for that one, that starts out with Men in Black 3. I already posted a video review of this, but it was at least better than Men in Black 2, thank God. But I mean, seriously, it's Men in Black. It's like, you know, you could take, but as it is, first of all, it's at least creative and with its premise. It's at least creative with its premise. But there are still some holes in the plot, and there needs to be there are some issues that really needed to be addressed, that really should have been addressed better. Like, how does Agent J get recruited into MIB if Agent K was killed before that could happen? How does Agent J remember everything about the original timeline? I mean, might have been something or other. I mean, there was something or other that Tommy Lee Jones was doing as Agent K, but it wasn't really explained. And I really wish that had been explained a bit better. And then, of course, there was also, there was a device that Agent K was using that might have caused something about that, but I don't know how it works or what it's supposed to do, so I wish that had been explained a bit better. And then, another thing was it really dragged at the beginning. It really just felt like it was just doing a bunch of tired jokes and was just boring and dull at the beginning. It didn't feel like it was going much anywhere until it finally got into the 1960s. And until it finally got to the whole time travel aspect of the plot. And that's when it finally started getting interesting. And then another thing was, I still don't see why this needs to exist. I mean, I didn't see why Men in Black 2 needed to exist. But at least this one was at least okay, but I still don't see the reason for it needing to exist at all. It's just a pure case of, I mean, this is another case of a film that didn't need a sequel in the first place. I mean, the original Men in Black was just fine on its own. It was a good movie. It could have just been, you know, if they just left it alone with the first film, it would have been just fine. But this film, while it's okay, it doesn't feel like it needs to exist, and that's one of the big, another really big thing that's going against this. So as it is, I'd say if you're gonna check it out, give it a rental. It's not really worth too much more than that, but it was okay. I mean, you will be, I mean, I'm not gonna say it's gonna be anything great, but I mean, just if you're really looking for a really good movie, I'd say just pass on it and go find something else. Anyways, after that is one of only two animated films I saw last year. No, correction, three. Wow, I've only seen three. And I've seen one of every single style of animation last year. I saw one, so I saw a CG film, I saw a traditionally animated film, and then I saw, well, technically the traditionally animated film also had some CG in it too, because I'll get more into that later. And then I also saw a stop motion film. And at the bottom of my list is the DreamWorks, the one CG film that I saw last year. And that was DreamWorks' Madagascar 3, Europe's Most Wanted. I was really, just kind of, when I saw this, I just kind of meh. It was just kind of a case of, again, I don't see why this needed to exist. Another thing that, but one of the things that I think was a little, was the thing that was really making, giving this problems was, it had, I felt like that there was not a lot of focus in the film. There was a lot of, first of all, the only character that I think has an arc, goes through an arc, of the original four characters from Madagascar is Alex, played by Ben Stiller. And as opposed to the second film, where almost all the characters went through arcs. And that's part of the reason why the second film is still the best to me. And sorry, just stretching out a little bit here. And it's just a case of it's just a case of lack of focus, I guess. It's just kind of the story that they got there is fine, I'll admit, but I felt like it could have been told in, like, maybe 45 minutes. You didn't need a theatrical film this long, I think. It was not very... I mean, there was quite a bit of filler and... that was the biggest problem. There was quite a bit of filler and quite a lot of jokes that were just fell flat and were really, I mean, there were some jokes that were very good. There were some jokes that got me laughing out loud. And then there were also some jokes that had me cringing. Of course, this is a kid's movie, so there's obviously going to be some random kid humor thing that is not going to appeal to me as an adult, so... It just, it's not nearly as good as some of DreamWorks' other films, obviously. I mean, the first two Shrek films are obviously better than this. Obviously, I said Madagascar 2 was better than this. But I mean, like, you know, you know, it's like, it's obviously nowhere nearly as good as How to Train Your Dragon, but it was still, it's an okay kids movie. I'd say if you're getting this for your kids, they will probably like it, but as an adult, for adults, it's like, you'll find some stuff there that'll definitely appeal to you, but it's not as good as other films, and again, another thing might be just my, and another thing is, another thing is with me, I'm just really getting tired of having too many CG animated films. I'm a guy that prefers traditional animation to CG animation. I just think it looks a lot better, and also I'm just tired of CG completely dominating the market. So I want to see a resurgence in traditional animation, hopefully. I mean, it's just feels, because, I mean, the thing is, animation is an art. I really think that people really need to recognize that animation is an art form, and you don't just shove aside different aspects of art because of the fact that it's you have new technologies to make art. I mean, just because we have, just because we were able to do perspective draw, we finally managed to do perspective drawing or perspective paintings and stuff like that. That doesn't mean that we didn't stop making sculptures, because beforehand, that was our only way to make things look realistic, and then we finally mastered perspective, and then we moved on, but even then, we still continued to make sculptures. But that, I mean, I have the same thing with traditional animation, and also with stop motion, although stop motion's kind of making a bit of a comeback, which is, kind of made a bit of a comeback this year, which is good. I hope that that's a sign of good things to come. And I hope that's also a sign that they might consider stepping back to doing more traditional animation, but I don't know if that'll ever happen. But, I mean, I just really don't have I'm not appealed to the whole CG thing, CG look. It just looks too plastic and too artificial to me. I mean, to me, nothing really beats a nice hand draw. A hand drawn character, I guess, because it just looks a lot better to me. Again, though, that's not discrediting DreamWorks, or any of their films. I'm not a fan of CG, and I really would wish that we would go back to you doing more, traditional animation. But yeah, it wasn't, aside from that, it wasn't as good as some of DreamWorks' other films. I think the two films that I saw last year from DreamWorks were a lot better. Those ones were Kung Fu Panda 2, which was quite good, actually, to be honest. I really like Kung Fu Panda 2. And then there was also Puss in Boots, which was okay. I mean, it was pretty good, but it wasn't that good. Good. So, yeah. I will say that it's a decent enough kids film, I guess. Well, you already know, people have already seen this, that will already know my opinions on The Dark Knight Rises. I'm not going to state too much about it. I'll just state that it was incredibly disappointing for me. I mean, I want to state something clear here. I do not want any arguments over Avengers versus Dark Knight Rises stuff or stuff like that. I do not want to have any of that competition or stuff going on here. Anyways, moving back on to my point. But yeah, Dark Knight Rises. I've already told you how I was very disappointed with this film. I still have not had the opportunity to see it again yet, but I'm hoping that maybe a second viewing will give me a better perspective on the film, but it still doesn't quite do that for me, and it's just something that I think could have been a lot better. And then, I feel like there's a lot of, it just really feels like that they try to cram way too much into the time frame that they were trying to do. A lot of people might complain that it was too long, but I will complain that it was too short. And that's the real problem. It just feels way too short for this something with a lot of material. I guess I could compare it as far as that case. I mean, it has very different flaws to this film, but I could probably compare it to Akira. If anybody has seen that film, it's an anime film from 1988 or 89. Can't remember if it was 88 or 89, but it's a cyberpunk anime film. It was based on the manga on a manga that was 6 volumes long, and and even though it was made by the same guy that made the manga, it was basically trying to condense all that material down to about 2 hours, and worse was the fact that the manga was not even finished yet by the time that the film was made. So that was something that really made the film feel. I mean, the film felt like there was a lot of stuff that was. I mean, like with Akira, it really felt like there was a lot of stuff that was missing. And if it had been maybe an hour longer, it could have fleshed stuff out more, and so that way things would have made a bit more sense. And I really wished, and again, it was like, if it just had more time, you could have had a really good movie. Same thing with The Dark Knight Rises. This film was just, was incredibly overwritten for the amount of time that it had. It was 2 hours and 45 minutes long, and I really wish it could have been longer, because there really was a lot of stuff that needed to have to be addressed. I also think that if they had made it longer, they could have eliminated a lot of the plot holes. It basically tries to combine a lot of aspects of different Batman source material, but most notably as Nightfall, No Man's Land, and The Dark Knight Returns. And I've only read Nightfall, well, at least part of Nightfall, but what little of it that I have read has been very good so far. I mean, I've only gotten to the point where it's basically just a little bit after Azrael has taken over briefly as Batman. So, yeah, I only got the first, like, mega volume of it, because Nightfall is a long, long story. And then, but yeah, there's Nightfall has been kind of, and then, so yeah, but I mean, but I haven't read No Man's Land or The Dark Knight Returns yet, and I intend on reading The Dark Knight Returns before I see The Dark Knight Returns animated films, because I want to see just how good the source material is. But of course, all three are very acclaimed Batman stories. And it's like, again, a case of, it's like, if you had more time, you could have, but, I mean, these are, like, some really dense Batman stories. There's a lot of plot going on in all three of these stories, and it's like, you really could have condensed it down to a much shorter amount of time, and it could have easily been a lot better, I would say. I also wish that this had been more... It seemed to have, from what it looked like, it seemed to have taken a lot from No Man's Land. Again, though, I haven't quite read No Man's Land yet, but I do want to read No Man's Land sometime. Again, I'm trying to get back into comics. I've been out of it for a while. Thanks to One More Day and Countdown to Final Crisis and other stuff. The other crap from these companies and stuff like that. I mean, I kind of gave up on comics for a while, and now only recently am I trying to get back in, and they keep trying to find ways to make me not read comics, and I hate that. Anyways, but I'm getting off track here, and I'm really wasting too much time on this, but I mean, that was really my main problem. Really felt like there was just too much material that could have been... I mean, if they had made... I really wish that they could have... made it longer, and they could have a little bit longer to flesh out everything that was going on. And also, again, make it more like Bane in Nightfall, so that way his motivations would make more sense, and the plot would make more sense as well. Up next is The Hobbit, An Unexpected Journey. This was the, obviously this is the beginning of the whole trilogy of films directed by Peter Jackson. I was a little bit, again, I can't say, I have to say I was kind of disappointed in this one too. Whereas The Dark Knight Rises, I felt like was way too, the pacing was way too fast, to the point where it was becoming, the plot was becoming really confusing. With The Hobbit, An Unexpected Journey, the plot was, it was way too slow. The good thing, though, was, and I think it was really getting bogged down with too much exposition and too many scenes that drag on for way too long. And the good thing about it, though, was I at least knew everything that was going on, and I at least could determine, you know, just kind of, at least it didn't really treat me like, I mean, it really did make sure that that the audience knew what was going on throughout the entire film, so that was good. But as it is, I really have to state that The Hobbit, its pacing is way too slow, and I mean, my brother said that it did do a really good job of trying to be accurate to the book, because I haven't read the book. I don't really read too much. I mean, I don't know why, but I can read comics fine, but when I'm reading a novel, it can become very, I just do not have a good enough attention span to read novels and stuff like that very often, so that's just kind of me, I guess. Anyways, but this movie was, really just, I mean, it really just felt like this pacing was way too slow, it was way too deliberate, and it really needed to be more... I really wish that it was more tout, and it was more, it just had a much better, it really didn't, that it didn't get itself so bogged down with exposition and stuff like this, and didn't get so I really do not, you know, I really do not think that this movie, I keep looking at it, and it kind of felt like it was introducing a lot of subplots that didn't really need to go, that really didn't, I mean, my brother said that it was actually introducing things from other material that was, other Tolkien material as well, and I really feel like, you know, if you're gonna do that, then just, why not just tell a Hobbit as it is, and forget about all these extraneous subplots. We don't need all these things. I mean, it just really drags the pace. You don't want to introduce too many subplots and not give them much of a thing. It's going to really drag the pace, and it's going to make the film feel incomplete, I guess. Not incomplete, but you know what I mean. I will state this, though, the very ending of this film, towards the very end of this film where Gollum finally comes in, that is a very, very well-crafted scene where Bilbo and Gollum are both having that, like, game of riddles or game of wits or whatever. Yeah, game of riddles. And it was really, that was a really very well-crafted scene, and I was very impressed with just how well they managed to execute that scene. By far the best scene in the whole film. I mean, but as it is, I mean, if you're obviously going to see the rest of the trilogy, you need to see this film, obviously, in order to be up to date with what's going on. But I felt like it was way too long, and it could have been much shorter. I mean, the Lord of the Rings films felt like they needed to be that long to keep all that plot that was going on, basically within the keep all that plot that was going on. This doesn't feel like it needed to be that long. I mean, I felt like you could have condensed all the material possibly to just two films, and it would have been fine. And that was the original intent, but then they decided to make it a trilogy, and I'm not sure if that was the best idea. Anyways, so then after that, we've got The Hunger Games. I do think that this film was a little bit overhyped. I mean, I will still say that the performances... Oh, by the way, I will state this. Martin Freeman's performance as Bilbo was excellent in The Hobbit, as was most of the performances. But again, I was really anticipating his performance... And he still did a very good job. He did kind of put a little bit of Watson in there, but it did feel like he at least did do a very... But, I mean, he at least made it his own, and he really made it... Sold that role, I guess. So, a great job there on Martin Freeman's part. Anyway, so up next is The Hunger Games. This had some fairly consistent acting throughout. I did feel like one of the biggest problems that I had with this film, though, was there were some things that needed better explanation. And they didn't... I mean, there was a few points in the film that were a little bit confusing where you're a little bit confused as to what's going on. But it didn't affect the overall film, I will at least state that much. And it was a film that I really liked the fact that it was actually pretty smart compared to most of these films based off of young adult fiction. I mean, it's like, I mean, you know, we've got stuff like Twilight and crap like that right now. I mean, now that the Harry Potter films are done, it's like you don't really have much good stuff out there, and it's really... And, I mean, this whole young adult fiction thing has really just kind of become a fad, which is a little bit unfortunate, which is really kind of unfortunate. Even though I'm not much a reader, I would definitely encourage more people to read books. Just read in general. I mean, I get most of my reading through comic books and magazines, or at least I'm trying to get back into comic books. Again, though, Marvel and DC keep trying to piss me off. I might need to actually start picking up some Image comics, because I haven't really picked up many of those yet. But anyways, it's just a really I was really just absolutely. But yeah, as it was, I was just. I mean, I thought it was pretty decent, but I think that some things needed to be explained a bit better. Okay, so then after that, these are the movies that I thought were decent to good, basically. So after that, we've got Justice League Doom. This is the one direct-to-video feature that came out last year that I saw. This is based on the graphic novel Justice League Tower of Babel, I think. Of course, they change up a lot of plot details. I actually haven't read the source material for this, but but I did see the movie. I mean, from what I read off the description, on Wikipedia, they changed up a lot of stuff. I believe in Tower of Babel, the main villain was Ra's al Ghul, but in this one, it's, Vandal Savage. And, I will state this, though, the Vandal Savage's villain plan, at least up until the very last part of it. I mean, the way that he manages to find ways to basically kill or disable all the superheroes is phenomenal. I mean, I was really impressed. Well, of course, though, he stole those plans from Batman. And of course, Batman being the guy that plans ahead, he came up with several different ways. He stole a bunch of plans from Batman's computer to basically find a bunch of ways to kill all of these, basically either kill or disable all these superheroes, so that they Batman came up with these plans to disable all the superheroes in case they all went rogue or something, like one of them went rogue or all of them went rogue or something like that, and it was very. Just very, and they were some very clever, there were some very clever plans there that I felt were really, really cool. But, up until like the very end part of the plan, which was just kind of like a little ridiculous, but, where we finally see where their final parts of their ultimate world domination goal come about, but it was still that was definitely one of the best parts of the movie. I felt like every single hero in this was in genuine danger, and that was good. And then I also was, I did notice some inconsistencies, however, and again, I did notice some inconsistencies in the overall plot, and I felt like that was what weakened the film for the most part. And there was also some points where I had the biggest inconsistency. I keep having this problem with kryptonite. I mean, I don't know. Well, kryptonite's really, it's really confusing, the stuff they do with kryptonite as is the DC universe, but I mean, again, there was some inconsistencies with kryptonite. I wish they would just be consistent with kryptonite for once. Anyways, but yeah, I thought it was fairly good. If you see it, I mean, if you're a big DC fan, I'm not sure if it's going to appeal to many other people other than that, but if you're a pretty big DC fan, or just a pretty big comic fan in general, I'd say give this a pick. Pick this one up. It's not as good as Batman Under the Red Hood, but it's definitely better than Superman Batman Apocalypse. So yeah, definitely give this one a check. Just give this one a look, because it's a decent flick. Then after that comes another superhero film, and this one was the one that came out in theaters. The Amazing Spider-Man. Again, I've already stated my review about this. I'll try to keep this one short. I really liked what was good in this was really good. I really liked the I liked the characterization of Peter Parker better in this than I did the one in the Raimi films. I like the overall. I like the just the chemistry that all the actors had was very good as well. Very well acted movie. The overall plot had some inconsistency. Had some inconsistencies and plot holes, although, and of course there was a couple of subplots that were abandoned. Although at least this one had a plot that was resolved, unlike The Hobbit, which just kind of ended at a point. I mean, The Amazing Spider-Man it still felt like semi-conclusive. I mean, it wasn't completely conclusive. I mean, there was definitely some dangling plot threads that should have been dealt with. But as it was, I felt like it was a decent start to the series, and I'm looking forward to the next part in the series. I've heard about some of the casting calls, and I heard that they're gonna have Electro and Rhino, I guess, was the other one. I'm a little surprised they're doing Rhino. I mean, Rhino's basically the villain that's known for being just kind of stupid. I mean, he's the guy that's basically bronze over brains. But Electro, I'm definitely looking forward to them doing. And they hired Jamie Foxx. I mean, of course, Electro in the comics is white, but of course, Jamie Foxx is black. But I don't care about that. I don't care about that at all. I think that if they can do it well, I'll definitely be. If they just do the role well, I will definitely be into what they're going to be doing with it. Doing with this, I mean, I hope that if they can do anything, they could base it a little bit off of his character in the Spectacular Spider-Man series, because that was I really like what they did with Electro in that series. Made him a very sympathetic character. In that, a very sympathetic villain in that series. And then, but yeah, plus the fact that he was voiced by Crispin Freeman, one of the best voice actors out there, so that made it even better. But I mean, this, The Amazing Spider-Man was definitely a decent movie. I hope that this movie could, I kind of hope that the movie, I mean, it wasn't quite as good as I was hoping it would be, but it was still good enough. And I'm definitely looking forward to the sequel, and I hope that they can tell a little bit more. If they can just make the story more cohesive, they can. I'm sure that they can make a very good movie, because it had very good direction, very good. Again, what was good in this movie was very good. There was just those bad aspects that kind of kept it from being a classic. Then after that, we've got 21 Jump Street. You know, this is strange. This is the only live-action comedy I saw this year. Okay, maybe you could count Django Unchained, but, Tarantino's films are kind of a combination of dark humor, dark comedy, and also drama as well. This was mostly pure comedy, and my God, it was hilarious. It was hilarious. I mean, there were some points where it wasn't quite as funny as other points, but it got, oh man, the climax of this film was absolutely hilarious. When the plot really was reaching its peak, it just got to the point where I was just laughing out loud at everything that was going on. This was a really funny movie, and I guess my only complaint was they really overdid it on the swearing, but I didn't care too much because it was just hilarious. So, this is strange though. It was the only live action comedy I saw this year. I wanted to see more of them, but I didn't end up seeing them. But yeah, definitely. This was definitely a very, very funny film, so definitely go see this. Go give this one a look if you're looking for great comedy films. Up next is Lincoln. I thought it was good, but I did think that it was a little bit overhyped, and I also did think that do not think that it deserves Best Picture. I do think that Daniel Day-Lewis does deserve Best Actor, but then again, Daniel Day-Lewis is a fantastic actor as is. So, but this was a, this was a little, there were a few scenes that I think dragged on a bit further than they needed to, and, I understand a slow-paced film, but, I understand that it was trying to be slow-paced, which is fine. I like a lot of slow-paced films, but it felt like there were some points where it was dragging on longer than it needed to at times. But I was really, it was a really very well-done political drama and historical political drama. And I love both of those. And it was very, I love the very, the really humanizing elements of this film and how it really made, how it really made the whole thing very compelling. And I was glad that unlike a lot of biopics, it doesn't, like, where a lot of biopics make the mistake of doing the whole, you know, trying to do their whole life, and it's like, it takes a while to get to the interesting parts. This film just got right to the place where it was very interesting, and I was really very pleased with the, did very, very much like this film, I definitely think it was definitely better than War Horse, Spielberg's film from last year, which I did not like really that much at all. I thought that one was way too sappy. But this one actually felt like there was more of an emotional payoff too, so, and was definitely much more compelling, and I very much appreciated the message that I was trying to go for in this film, that it gave out in this film. Very relevant message while still definitely keeping with the whole of the historical aspect of it. The one thing I wish it hadn't done though was it kind of mentioned its message at one point a little bit too directly. I mean, its message, but it was definitely something that, but I mean, by the, that, I mean, it mentioned the word that I think it shouldn't have mentioned. But it's definitely was a very, but it was definitely a very good film, and I was really, really impressed by it. I really, really was very impressed by just the overall amount of heart that was put into this film. It definitely feels like a Spielberg film, but I mean, as it is, it's still a very good film. Django Unchained. Well, it's Tarantino. You know, I really have to confess this. This is only the second Quentin Tarantino film I've ever seen. And I'll attribute that to two things. One, I was raised in a Roman Catholic family, and two, his films are rated R for good reasons. I only saw Pulp Fiction back around early December of last year. I saw it in the theaters though, when they were promoting Tarantino's 20th anniversary collection, and I was glad to be able to get to see it in the theater, because it was, and not to mention just the fact that the film was very, very, very good. Might go on to become one of my favorite films, although then again, I've seen several films over the past year that could go on to become one of my favorite films. But Django Unchained, it was still very good, but it wasn't as good as Pulp Fiction, but then again, I was not expecting it to be as good as Pulp Fiction. There's really only one thing that keeps this from being, getting a slightly higher score on my list and becoming a classic. And that was just some minor plot holes that really should have been addressed, and that was the point where I think was a little bit was just a little. If those plot holes had been addressed, it could have been. But again, it's like very, very minor stuff. very, very minor aspects of the film. They don't really take away from the whole film. Oh, and by the way, you know, actually there were three films this year. I mean, there were like three films that had absolutely hit. I mean, the Amazing Spider-Man, 21 Jump Street, and Django Unchained all have very hilarious cameos, and I really was trying to think really hard which one was the best cameo, and I think I'm gonna have to go with Quentin Tarantino's traditional cameo appearance in his own films. In Django Unchained was absolutely hilarious. I mean, I'll talk about that later when I get to the awards. But yeah, definitely, if you're a fan of Tarantino, you'll still love this. You'll love this film. So, me, I'm just getting into him, but I've definitely liked what I've seen so far from him. So, I'm looking. So yeah, still very good. Not as good as Pulp Fiction, but then again, that's going up against Pulp Fiction. So, definitely pick this one up if you get the chance. I think it's still in theaters. So if you haven't seen it in theaters yet, definitely go see it. If it's not still in theaters, then my bad. Okay, Dredd 3D. Oh, I really wish that this film had not bombed. Part of the reason why I put up my review of this film was because of the fact that it was not performing well in U.S. box offices, and I will attribute that to three things. The first thing was the original Stallone film. I mean, I personally find it to be a guilty pleasure. It's one of those so bad it's good movies. But yeah, as it is, the original Stallone film is still bad, and it's not really looked fondly upon by a lot of people, it's one of those terrible, just absolute, I think they were basing it, like, a lot of people were looking at it like, you know, why would you base this off of that, why would you remake that awful Sylvester Stallone film? Which obviously tells me that not enough people are familiar with the source material, because Judge Dredd is technically a comic book character, and was definitely a much better version than was in that first film. I haven't read the comics, but I might want to get into reading them. After having seen this, but I definitely will want to get into reading them after seeing this film. The only things that I really have to say that I didn't really like were a couple instances of, you know, it's like there's good ideas, but it's not quite able to flesh them out. But that's mostly because it's really just setting itself up for a sequel to further flesh out the universe over time. But the good thing about this one, unlike the other two films, it had a really, really tight script. So that way, I mean, it's like, it sets itself up in a universe where you could tell further stories, but it tells this one story that's very cohesive and coherent and just works really well. It catches your interest, and you're really into it really just catches your interest, and man... This film was relentless, had a relentless pace. This is the kind of action movie I have wanted to see for a while now. And I was this close to giving this a rating as a classic. I gotta say that. I was this close. I mean, if it just had been, I mean, it really, I mean, I just kind of, it just kind of like, you know, it's like, there's definitely points that are kind of set up here, but I at least didn't get bogged down with that setup to the point that where it really took away from the overall plot, but it was just so good. But I mean, just the main plot as it was just one of those so simple it cannot fail, and it just does it so well. Great action scenes, great just very tight pacing, great script, excellent script to be honest. And man, I was just floored by how relentlessly awesome this movie was. definitely check this one out if you have not gotten it yet. Try to get this on Blu-ray. Get this on Blu-ray so that way it'll boost up the sales, and then that way they'll possibly consider making a sequel to this. That's what I'm going to state right now, because it's out on DVD and Blu-ray. Get it on Blu-ray. If the Blu-ray sales manage to be high enough, we might be able to get another sequel out of this. I don't know though if it'll end up just going to the direct-to-video market, though. I hope it doesn't. And then the other two things that I attribute to it were well, Lionsgate, who can't market stuff to save their lives. And then finally, another thing that really was really damning of this movie, that really was the trailer. The trailer for this film, for Dredd 3D, sucked. I gotta say that it was a terrible trailer. It just made it look like a really generic action flick, and forgettable action flick. And then I saw the movie, and I was just... Then I actually saw the movie, and I was just floored by just how relentless it was. And I was, I mean, again, definitely go see this. Anyways, so as I said, this was kind of on the cusp of being a classic, so now I move on to the films that I consider to be a classics. These are films that I think you all definitely should see, that you all definitely should see no matter what, if you have not seen them already. Okay, so, at the bottom of the, basically rounding these out is, at the bottom of these is, Looper. This had a fairly shaky beginning, I will admit. It had, some points where it's kind of, there were a couple minor plot holes, and there was also some points where they're kind of stretching logic, but it really does manage to make a very, manages to make construct a very smart sci-fi action flick. But unlike Dredd 3D, which was more action than sci-fi, this was more sci-fi than action. And it's got a very smart sci-fi premise, and I was very pleased. I mean, almost everything that's introduced is paid off, and it manages to tell a very, very good story to it, and it was just so much. Just did a really good job at making a very smart and thought-provoking sci-fi action film. And of course, it has both Joseph Gordon-Levitt and Bruce Willis both do great jobs in their roles, and Levitt does a great job trying to be a younger version of Bruce Willis, and they obviously kind of had to put quite a bit of makeup on his face to make him look a little bit more like Bruce Willis. But even if he didn't have that makeup, but you could have all that makeup, you could definitely I could definitely just buy him in that role playing Bruce Willis. And it was a very, very good, very, very good sci-fi action flick. It's definitely this one's more sci-fi than action, and I was very, just very pleased with this film. It was, if you have not seen it yet, definitely check this one out. Very, very good film. The Pirates, Band of Misfits. This film was done by Aardman Animation, well-known British animation studio. I've been a big fan of theirs ever since I was a kid, watching the old Wallace and Gromit shorts. I love pretty much almost all the stuff that they've done. Of course, in more recent times, they've been doing CG, and I was really glad to hear that they were doing another stop-motion film. And, man, I was really... And, again, it was just... It wasn't quite as good as either Chicken Run or... It wasn't quite as good as Chicken Run or Wallace and Gromit: Curse of the Were-Rabbit, but I still was just really loved this film. It was definitely a very British film, and I was very unapologetic about that, and I really loved that. Part of it is I just really like British comedy and British. The British humor typically, it's a lot better than American comedies now, a lot oftentimes nowadays, and it's just really was very, I was, it just really knew what it was. This was like really a case of where it really knew what it wanted to be, and it made a film just so, and the film was just such, had just such amount of great humor. And it had a lot of heart, and it was definitely both accessible to kids and adults. So, and if you're a big fan of Aardman like me, you'll definitely want to go check this one out. So, I love this film. Definitely go see this one if you pick this one up if you haven't seen it yet. Next film is Chronicle. This is the first film I saw last year. And it was by far it was a very good way for me to start out the year, because it was a very good film. I was very, very impressed by just the amount of effort that was really put into the story of this film. It was made by a couple of new filmmakers, directed by Josh Trank, and it was basically made on a pretty slim budget, but they managed to make the film that they wanted to make with that slim budget, and it managed to do the whole stuff, the whole found footage thing in a way that was actually very creative, and for once, I actually kind of found a found footage film that I liked. Part of it was, it wasn't just a horror film, it was definitely a bit scary, but I mean, there was more aspects of a, it was definitely a character study, more than anything. Well, a study of multiple characters. Basically, I describe it, it's like, going back to Akira, and a lot of people compared it to Akira, and part of that's because it was influenced by Akira. If you took Akira and condensed it down to where it's just focused on the main characters, and in that case, I actually think it's better than the film. Not necessarily better than the manga, but better than the film. For sure, because of the fact that this one has a really tight focus to it, and it really makes a really good, really, really good story out of it, and it's really, you really care about the characters, and you really, it really makes the characters very likable and very sympathetic, and it only makes the films, emotional grasp to it. I gotta admit, I did get a little bit teary-eyed at the very end of this film. It has a very touching ending at the very end of the film, and it was a very, it knew exactly what it, how to pay off, how to end it, end the film, really. And it just, well, I mean, even though the ending action scene, though, that was one of the main complaints I had. I mean, obviously because it was made on a budget, the ending action scene did feel a little bit incomprehensible, and also it's kind of strange, because it's basically like several different camera. Unlike most found footage films, it switches between several different cameras that are filming right at that point and are kind of telling the story, showing the story as it progresses. And there are also some points where you're like, you wouldn't think that they'd actually be filming at this point, but it does manage to make something really, really, just a really, really good film. And the director, Josh Trank, has recently been announced that he'll be getting the he's going to be making the new it was recently announced that he's going to be directing the new Fantastic Four film, which I'm definitely looking forward to now. I mean, I want to get that the one from the 2000s out of my head, because the two films from the 2000s out of my head, because I really do not like those films. And then and obviously there's the Roger Corman one, which I have not seen, but I mean almost everybody tells me that it's terrible, and I believe, don't get me wrong, I believe them. I believe it's terrible, but I mean, it's hard. I haven't had taken the time to actually watch the film yet, so. I'm really glad that that's the case. And the one thing I don't like about it, though, is that it's setting itself up with the X-Men in the X-Men universe. And while that could lead to crossovers, the problem is, I just don't think that the X-Men makes sense in the context of the Marvel Universe. I mean, it would make more sense. It would only make whole concept of the X-Men makes sense when there's no other superheroes around. It doesn't make sense when it doesn't make a lot of sense with all these superheroes around and stuff like that. I just really wish that they would make that they could do something that would make I just really wish that they could do something that. But I mean, you know, the Fantastic Four would make more sense teaming up with the Avengers than they would teaming up with the X-Men, I would say. That's my big problem with it. Anyways, I'm getting off track. It's definitely, Chronicle was a very good movie. If you have not seen it yet, definitely go check it out. And of course, the first movie review that I ever did, and, it was, of course, that film, of course, is Marvel's The Avengers, and it would have been number one had three other films not come out and been better than it. What can I say? Great, great superhero film. I just loved this film. It was one of the best superhero films I have ever, it's one of the best superhero films I have ever seen. It's, I think only The Dark Knight and Batman Mask of the Phantasm, I'd say, place above this on my list. It's definitely a very, very good film, and I absolutely loved it. It was, this is the only film that I ended up seeing twice. I ended up seeing it two weeks in a row, at the first week, and then I went again to go see it the week afterwards, because, I mean, it was just so much fun, and I really wanted it. I mean, it has a lot of rewatch value, and it's like Star Wars in that case. It's one of those films that where it's like you really want to watch it again after having watched it only once, and that's a sign of making a great blockbuster film, that you made a great blockbuster film. I really got to commend Joss Whedon on this. I mean, I wasn't quite as I was definitely anticipating this film, but I wasn't quite as much anticipating this as the other two films that came out, but this one ended up being my favorite of all of them, and man, I loved it. Again, it would have been number one if it had not been for the next three films on my list. Oh, and the next two films, I was really trying to debate as to where I would put them. But I decided to put this one just slightly below the next one because there were a few plot points that felt a little contrived to me, but that didn't take away at all from just how much I love this film, and that was the latest James Bond film, Skyfall. I absolutely love this movie, and I think this is going to go on to become one of my favorite Bond films as well. I'm probably behind just Dr. No and From Russia with Love, I would say. I mean, I was really impressed by what they did with this film, and they took a lot of... They managed to take a lot of risks while still being very respectful to the James Bond mythos and all that stuff, and basically trying to... It basically is one of those films that's trying to prove that this franchise is still relevant, and it does a really good job at that. I absolutely love this film, and I really wish that I would have had more time to go see it again, because I would have loved to have seen it again, but I didn't end up seeing it again, unfortunately. But just, man, and the writing was so good in this movie. I mean, just such great writing, such great dialogue. I loved it. I absolutely loved it. One of the best Bond films yet. Definitely go see Skyfall if you haven't seen it yet. I mean, probably most of you have already seen this, so... But just, man, I loved this film. Absolutely loved it. So then after that, we have Zero Dark Thirty. And again, that was the film that came out in 20... In my area in 2013, but technically came out in 2012. So, but yeah, this was the whole Bin Laden film. The whole film that basically detailed the hunt for Bin Laden. Actually, from what I heard, this was actually going into production before Bin Laden was actually killed. And then when Bin Laden was killed, they decided to add that into the plot of the film. And I was I'm not sure how historically accurate it is, but if it definitely brings up a lot of events in recent history and puts them into context very well. But even if it's not, I could very much buy that it was, and it was definitely a very, very, very good film. With just how much attention to detail was put into this film. It was just absolutely astounded by how much love and care went into the making of this film. And I do not agree with the people that say that this movie drags, because it does not. A lot of people will complain that it drags at the points where it's mostly in the office areas, but I didn't feel like that was the case, because the one thing that I might complain about, though, is, you know, my dad said it kind of felt like a made-for-TV film, and now I was kind of trying to wrap my mind around why he was thinking that, but now I think I might have wrapped my mind around that. It's because of those, parts of the film, where they're often at the desks, basically just working there on the desks and stuff like that, but it was, just as it was a fantastically crafted movie. Well-crafted movie, and I absolutely was very, very pleased with how well made this film was, and fantastic writing, great direction, great acting. I mean, I would hope that either this or the film that comes right above this would end up winning Best Picture this year, and that other film was, well, my favorite film of the year, Argo. This was Ben Affleck's third film. I haven't seen his first two films that he's directed, but, my God, I loved it. This film was just absolutely near perfect, and I just could not believe how well made this film was, and just how they really put a lot of love and care into making this film, and they really did make a really, really good... They basically really made a really, really good movie that was very... I really loved the... and again, another case of a lot of attention to detail, and a lot of attention to... This one, definitely, I could definitely say that... I mean, there was definitely some areas where there were probably some historical inaccuracies, but there was definitely a lot of historical accuracy to it, and definitely was very... very compelling, and just a very gripping and thrilling film, and I really hope that this ends up winning Best Picture, and it's kind of looking up now with having won the Directors Guild Award, and I really wish that Ben Affleck, along with Catherine Bigelow for Zero Dark Thirty, had been nominated for Best Director, because, man, this was such a well-directed film. And very great, very good script, too. Probably the best script I've... Probably the best script of the entire year. And, of course, that would make the best film of the year. So, with that all out of the way, so yeah, Argo is my favorite movie of the year. Definitely give that, check that one out if you haven't seen it yet. So that's about all for me on that. So now we've got just some awards here for the year. For Best Actor, I'm giving it to Daniel Day-Lewis for his performance as Lincoln. Great performance there, without a doubt. I definitely hope he wins that. Hope that Lincoln Lincoln at least wins that Oscar. For Worst Actor, that's going to Taylor Kitsch for John Carter. Just put up the most boring performance I've seen. Second most boring performance I've seen all year, and definitely the worst. It was just really... Just was really bland, I think. And then Best Actress goes to Jessica Chastain as Maya in Zero Dark Thirty. I almost didn't have somebody for this role, but for this thing, but then I ended up seeing Zero Dark Thirty, whose main character was a woman. So basically, she was gonna win. She was pretty much gonna win anyways. But even then, Jessica Chastain did a very, very good job as the main job in the role. Great performance. For Worst Actress, Kristen Stewart, as Snow White and Snow White and the Huntsman. No way she was not gonna win that award. Then again, as I must state, though, the script was not helping her at all, so... for Best Supporting Actor, I give it to Leonardo DiCaprio as Calvin J. Candy in Django Unchained. Probably one of the best villains. I had a hard time choosing best villain this year. So, but yeah... Best Supporting Actress, even though I was disappointed in The Dark Knight Rises, I will still give that to Anne Hathaway as Selina Kyle / Catwoman in The Dark Knight Rises. I mean, even though I do think that she was underutilized, she just nailed that performance, and I was absolutely just floored by her performance. I just wish that she was given more to do and was given a character arc, which was unfortunate. All-Star of the Year is Joseph Gordon-Levitt. Man, this guy was doing a lot of stuff in the last, like, several months of the year. He had a lot of films been coming out, and he's done... And in every film that I saw featuring him, he did a very good job in all the roles that he was in, and just really sold it, I would say. In every single role that he did, and he was definitely up for Best Actor for his performance in Joe in Looper, but unfortunately didn't end out going to it. So my award for Best Director in a Bad Movie, that goes to Ridley Scott. I mean, the direction was fantastic, script was awful. There was no way, I mean, even with the greatest director ever, you cannot save a crappy script. Best Hero goes to Captain America for Marvel's The Avengers. I had a hard time picking this, but I definitely went for Captain America, because, I mean, the Captain America that I saw on that screen, it was just like the Captain America from the comic books, just jumped right off the page onto the screen, and I was just, man. And it was strange, because I'm not typically a fan of Chris Evans, but man, Joss Whedon really got a good performance out of him. I think that his performance was very underrated. His performance as Captain America was very underrated, and I think that he definitely the best performance was by far Robert Downey Jr. and Mark Ruffalo, but I definitely think that Chris Evans, definitely deserved more respect for that role, because he really just nailed it. And again, a lot of it was the script and the direction, because, I mean, damn, Joss Whedon knew how to write Captain America. Wow. Anyways, best villain. This one was hard to. This one was damn hard, I gotta say, because there were some great villains on the screen this year. But I have to go with Antonio Silva from Skyfall. One of those instances where they took risks. Where they really took risks with the villain in the Bond film, and it really paid off. And I really just absolutely loved it. I was really just absolutely love just how, you know, just how twisted this guy was, and just kind of like how he was just not psychologically well, and you could tell that, and just absolutely was one of the best, he has a very good dichotomy with James Bond, and that's part of what made this film so good. Worst trailer for a good movie. That goes to Dredd 3D. I already stated that, but, I mean, it really made it look like a generic action flick, and not much more, but, man, the film itself was a lot better than I was thinking it was going to be. I mean, my brother and my dad both were thinking that it was going to suck. Part of it was because they saw the trailer. And they ended up seeing the film, and they actually said it was actually pretty good. So yeah, definitely their best trailer for a bad movie, Prometheus. Again, I'm just preaching to the choir here about how much I did not like Prometheus. Best director goes to Quentin Tarantino for Django Unchained. Definitely keeps it up. Definitely keeps it up and keeps it, like, he's definitely knows how to really jump around with, really just come jump around and make a bunch of, definitely knows how to make a very well-directed film, and where he'll make films, he'll make it unique, but he'll definitely give it its own stamp. I mean, you know it's a Tarantino film when you see one, and definitely Tarantino put his stamp on that film. Worst director goes to Andrew Stanton for John Carter. Once again, proves my case. Once again, proof of my point that animation directors do not necessarily make a great live action directors. I mean, he did direct Finding Nemo, which was great, but he didn't. I mean, it's like, again, the mediums don't really transition very well. Although I've heard Brad Bird managed to transition quite well from quite well actually from animation to live action with the most recent Mission Impossible film, but I have not seen Mission Impossible Ghost Protocol yet, but which is unfortunate because I really wanted to see I really wanted to see MI4, but I didn't end up seeing it, unfortunately. And it's just absolutely was, but yeah, it definitely really stands more to that case. I mean, I keep saying that animation directors don't always really transition that well to live action, and this was a good case of where that didn't quite go that well. Then again, the script also caused a lot of problems, but you know, Ridley Scott got a terrible script and managed to make it at least somewhat tolerable thanks to great direction, but it still, that doesn't help the fact that the script still sucked. For best script, that one goes to Argo. I mean, just a very well-written movie, and absolutely, just a second here. Well, obviously, the best scripts and the worst scripts are going to go to the best and worst movies of the year. But yeah, best script definitely goes to Argo. Very, very, very well-written movie. Was definitely knew how to make a very compelling and tight story and give you characters that you really liked, alongside just making a film that was just both very insightful as along with being very entertaining, and that's just a sign of just great filmmaking. And I really hope that Ben Affleck can continue to keep directing films. Again, haven't seen much of the other. An honorable mention, though, must go to Catherine Bigelow for Zero Dark Thirty, another very well-directed film. And I also haven't seen The Hurt Locker yet, but definitely after seeing Zero Dark Thirty, I want to see The Hurt Locker after seeing that. And then, of course, worst script goes to Snow White and the Huntsman. When you have bland, one-dimensional characters, an extremely plot full of contrivances, and unexplained phenomena and stuff like that, it's just, you're not helping. It doesn't help your script at all, and you end up coming up with a boring mess. And that's, I mean, there was no way that that was not going to get the worst script. I wish I could have given it to Prometheus because of how much I hated it, but, Snow White and the Huntsman was definitely the worst movie, and the script was what killed it. So, my God, I went an hour and 40 minutes doing this whole thing. So, yeah, that's about it. Well, I guess that's all for now. Take care, guys, and see you guys later. I'll try to get the Judas Priest review done sometime soon. Again, it's like, but though it's there's no set time as to when that's going to be coming out, so we'll just have to wait and see. See you guys later, and that's all for that's basically my overview of 2012. I thought it was, of the films that I wasn't exactly too impressed. I mean, the year didn't start becoming really good until, like, the very end of the year, and I was just absolutely, It didn't start to become really good until the very end of the year, and I was just a little bit disappointed at points, and I really wish that the movie had been a lot, that the year, I mean, the summer blockbuster year really didn't impress me very much, and I really wish that there had been more impressive stuff. It really didn't start to get really good up until around October, like, October, I guess, was when the quality really started to go up, and even then there were still probably, like, some films that I knew were going to be crap that came out, like Taken 2, even though I did like the original Taken, I knew that Taken 2 was going to be crap. I really just felt like a cash grab sequel, and that's pretty much what everybody's told me about what it was. And then, of course, Twilight, and then there was the Red Dawn remake. I'll probably make a video discussing about the films that I didn't see and why I didn't see them, so. But aside from that, that's about it. So, take care, guys, and see you later.